church that I've been at in 32 years.
Heard all about it. Where it failed. And amen. I can't say I felt any anointing at all in that. I was really searching. I really was. I wasn't criticizing or condemning. I was trying to feel, see if there's anything there. It wasn't anything there. Amen. A great introduction. I'm getting up to preach. Missy, pastor's wife, turns to me and says, I've got a great papers tonight. Hurry. Hurry. It's just really flowing here. Bottles in the air, boy. You can feel it, can't you? Okay. Pastor Brian, third time. Good to have you. Sorry, Pastor, that you had to come in on this tonight. This night that you picked. Appreciate Brother Brian. I'll be with him June. We believe, isn't that right? June? We said 28th through the 30th. So we're planning on y'all coming over there. Amen? He was faithful last time. That's where I met him. I was here and came to me, wanted me to come, or we talked on the phone or something. And open up tonight. We only got three nights tonight, tomorrow night, and Tuesday. So again, I want to preach what's right. Open up to Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 2. Deuteronomy 2. For every individual as well as ministry, pulpit or pew, church body, life, you got to progress. I want to teach, preach tonight while we're here. You've got to progress. So I have watched individuals over the years absolutely burn out. And everybody wants to know, how can you be on the mountain? How can you flow in the anointing like that preacher did and then you burn out? I'm going to tell you how. You don't progress. God has designed in us that you've got to see progression. It's an hourly wage. It's amazing. If you're making 10 an hour and your boss gives you 10 or 10, 20, 20 cents an hour, it'll buy you anything more in this economy. But there's something about it. Amen. One of the greatest things a boss can do is give you a quarter an hour raise. Amen. It don't cost him anything. It helps him.
Right.
It enhances his business. Because now you're there and you're excited, especially for a few months, till he gives you another nickel or quarter an hour raise. Why? It's progression. We're meant to progress. We got to have it. But the majority of churches don't see it. They battle all the time to progress. So numerics, numbers matter. Pumps up a pastor, no doubt about it. When you see those numbers and there's nothing like fresh blood in that family coming in. When that family comes in, a family of three or four, there's something about it. You benefit. You that's been here 5 years. You know how? You see it in his preaching. Somebody's new there in the regular services, a part of your church. So what is it? The law of progression. So we go to Deuteronomy, and we look at chapter 1. Thank you. And Moses said, then we turned, and we took our journey in the wilderness by the Red Sea, as the Lord spake unto me, and we compassed or circled Mount Seir many days. The Lord spake unto me, saying, watch this, you have compassed or circled this same mountain long enough. And then Moses said, God had spoke to him, tell the people, to turn you northward. Turn you northward. Close your Bible. Lay it beside you tonight. I want to talk about, we can call this message several things tonight. Northward bound. We could call it the law of progression. We could call it anything you want to call it. But tonight I want to talk about the law and the principle of it. I want to do my best to get this church to see this tonight. I felt it for this church. In chapters 1, 2, and 3 of Deuteronomy, Moses, to give you background, rehearses the children of Israel's wanderings from Mount Sinai to the place God took Moses home, Mount Nebo. You've heard it before. Preachers have preached about it. He went home and never had a chance to walk in Canaan's fair and happy land. God didn't rip Moses off by taking him to heaven. God rips nobody off by taking him to heaven.
Amen.
He digs the hole. He prepares the death, the burial. He plants Moses' body. God's the one that buried him in the earth. The body of Moses was so important that Satan himself, he didn't send a demon, he came himself to dispute over the body of Moses, and God didn't mess around either when he sent Michael, the heavenly fighting archangel, that showed up at the burial of Moses and said, Satan, the Lord rebukes you. There's something about the body of Moses that will show up in the last days. He rebuked him from the body of Moses. But here's what I want you to see about this. In the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible, Moses constantly, and after I preach this tonight, you'll see it, constantly reminds Israel of what God had done for them because they simply forgot it. We've heard it slip my mind. What about slip in your spirit? Israel had a taste of the land as Joshua and Caleb brought grapes so big back they had to put them on poles to carry them. The evidence of the great land that was out there was there. When God spoke to Moses and said, head north, he wasn't talking about heaven. He was talking about, like I'm not talking about heaven night for Hester Church. He was talking about get the people to a place on this earth that they've never been before. But for this to happen, Moses, you got to get them away from their comfort zone. You got to get them away from the mountain. Israel forgot some things. How do you forget it? Around whatever, 3 million Jews. For 3 million Jews to be fed proper food. One man said it was a conservative figure. This is conservative. 640 train boxcar loads of manna falling from the sky 12,600 consecutive days. 640 train boxcar loads of manna fell every morning from the sky 12,600 consecutive days. It rained like hail, H-A-I-L, to the earth. They forgot it. Sufficient bathing and drinking water. Conservative, 9 gallons of water per person a day. Don't sound like much until you multiply it 3 million people. 27 million gallons of water a day came out of a flint rock, and they forgot it. Their own heating, central heating and cooling system. As God gave them a pillar of fire by night, dropped down just enough heat to keep the baby's throats from getting sore in a cool evening. A cloud by day to block the sun rays that would burn their Jewish skin. To lead them as they followed the pillar of fire by night and the cloud by day, they could look over the shoulder. There was a flint rock that wasn't a mountain lance over on a mountain somewhere. It was following them wherever they went. Paul wrote to the Pentecost Church at Corinth, and through the passing down through the ancestry, he could not get away from this. When he said, oh, in 1 Corinthians 10, oh, and by the way, that rock which followed them. So we're on the R-O-C-K. What about the F-O-L-L-O-W-D? The rock that over their shoulder they would look, Missy, and there was a flint rock following them throughout the desert. And it was spewing out 27 million gallons of water a day. You know what happened? They forgot it. Later they act like none of it ever happened. He went before them as a devouring fire. He wiped out Amalekites, all the Ite boys, the Jebusites, the Amorites, the Philistines. Anybody that came against them, God would wipe them out. Like he's going to do Russia.
Yes.
Now that they form the alliance with Iran and the Medes.
Yes.
Iraq. Now they're in place for the Ezekiel 38-39 supernatural war where God said, I'll hook your jaw, I'll bring you in, then I'm going to show up and annihilate you.
Yep. Amen.
They're right there at the border of Israel.
Yes.
Over and over again, God did this. 40 years, people say, actually 38. A lot of action, a lot of movement, not much progression. Did you hear me? A lot of activity, church, a lot of action, not much The law of progression. There's more to this law in the Bible than sowing and reaping. There's been such an emphasis on sowing and reaping, we act like that's the only law of God that there is. There is a law that is as real as that will pump you back up, stir your spirit. Paul laid hands on Timothy when he was a little boy. He took him out of the arms of his mother and grandmother. But he writes to him, he laid hands on him, and there was an impartation as a little baby, as he held him to honor the mother and grandmother. But now he writes to Timothy and said, you got to do something now. You got to stir up the gift. It's laying dormant. You're a young man, but you stir up the gift that was given you back years ago when I laid hands on you and imparted. Impartation was in. But now you got to stir up the gift. What's the number one way to get the churches I go to and the pulpits too, Brother Lance, to stir everything back up? I'm telling you, the greatest stirring stick of all is the law of progression when you see it operating. Moses comes off the mountain. He's been with God. Not just the Ten Commandments is he given. He comes to Israel and he said, the Lord has spoken to me. He said, you have compassed, circled this same mountain long enough. God said, it's time to cut loose from your comfort zone. It's time to fight for progression or whatever you need to do. Because you're sitting there circling the same mountain and you're winding up the same spot. They moved. They had activity. Again, they didn't have progression. They were making ruts. You heard preachers preach it. What's the definition of a rut? Grave with both ends knocked out of it. A rut, when you wind up at the same spot in the sight of God, He sees things so different from the way we view it. We can be walking dead people, man. Our church can be dead. And we don't even know it. And everybody around it knows it that comes there. It's got any life but us. I'm telling you, man, as a Lutheran coming into this, first thing I saw, I'm telling you, what a lot of people, most people, call alive, God calls dead.
Yes.
What most people call vibrant and awake, God calls it sleeping. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it burns in my spirit for the churches. We have accomplished this same mountain long enough. We've wrestled with the same problems over and over again. We're in the same spot and we digress instead of progress. Listen, we got to find out what's wrong. You got to be careful of a tool, a trick of the devil. It ain't all about being nasty. It ain't all about being bad all the time. If we're not bad, we feel we're good. If we're not immoral, we feel, well, our morality is just super. We've fought off immorality in our land. We're doing great. Now listen to this. Watch this. Beware of spiritual contentment. Paul said, I know how to abase, I know how to abound. Whatever state I'm in, therewith am I therefore content. But when he raises the dead, he shakes snakes off of the fire. This is when he writes the scripture, that I might know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings. So Paul was saying, it don't matter if I'm raising the dead, shaking venomous vipers back off in the fire. He said, man, listen, I've got to progress. I've got to see myself getting somewhere. I've got to see this revelation of him coming alive. So he didn't save you to just get you to heaven. No. And I don't want him deceiving you to think that. We are saved and sanctified not just to be satisfied. We are his manifested body on this earth. We are the vehicle of expression. When you look at God and the kingdom of God and the progression of God, this is what he meant when he said it's a progressive walk with God that Paul said in the New Testament, we go from victory to victory, faith to faith. How do you do that? Glory to glory, power to power, joy to more joy, peace to a greater peace in God, revelation, knowledge of him, to greater revelation. But here's what our people have got to understand in the sight of God. If you are not going forward, you're going backwards. There's no end. Neutral, end, neutral on God's spiritual stick shift column.
That's right.
There is an F or there is an R. Amen. And someone, listen, people are always going to come. People are always going to go. You're never going to be able to satisfy everybody.
That's right.
So you don't worry about that. There will always be arguments. Welcome to human nature.
Yes.
Yep.
There will always be disagreements. So exactly what do I do? I don't count on whether they're coming or going like that to find out if progression is here. But for the faithful few that are here tonight, whatever you do, you've got to guard the staleness. You've got to guard the activity of moving and circling the same mountain. So when people make the statement about 38 years, you know, I could have called this message tonight 38 years to make an 11-day journey. 38 years to make an 11-day journey. The Bible tells us where the Jews started, where God wanted them to get to. I understand an 11-day trip, and you arrive on the 12th day. I'll cut you some slack. It's an 11-day trip. You show up, your group comes the 13th day. But my God, man, an 11-day trip. What are they doing 37 years and some odd days later? Yeah. They wound up, I'm telling you, around their same comfort zone. Uh-huh. They wound up not stepping out, moving forward. They're circling the same mountain. Wow. Sound like anybody you know? Mm-hmm. Sound like any church maybe we know? Mm-hmm. They could have been there in 11 days. 37 years later, they're still wondering. Because we know as Gentiles, looking back, there was something wrong. There was something wrong. You got to make up your mind. You got to move out of Dullesville. You got to make up your mind. I'm going to Holy Ghost City. You got to make up your mind. I refuse ruts. I refuse this. I am going north. I'm heading to a land of progression. North is where the clear stream was flowing. North was Canaan's happy land. North was shouting land. When they got there, the joy of the Lord overtook them. And there were some big battles and some giants in the land. I want you to understand this. Watch the physical picture for spiritual things that we learn in the Bible. When Israel was at point A and God told them to get to E, they had to go through B, C, D to get to E. Amen. You know what I noticed physically in that Bible? The enemy, when they started at A and wanted to get to E, the enemy never set up camp at FGHIJ. You know where the enemy always set up camp? All those Philistines and all those ites at BCD. When God said, you're at A, Israel, get to E. Check out BCD. The battles wasn't FGI, XYZ. The battles were at B, C, and D. They had to fight through. They had to go through it to progress. To get somewhere, they had to fight the good fight of faith. Fight, Timothy. Lay hold on eternal life. And he said, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hands suddenly on no man. There's a sin, there's a fight. That if you fight it, you've sinned by fighting it. There's a fight in that Bible. If you don't fight it, you've sinned. Mm-hmm. If you don't fight the good fight of faith, I'm telling you now, Hester, that's going through the obstacles. God has supplied some smooth stones for you in the land. The battles are big. The battles are ugly. The giants are huge. Most dreaded enemy of all for Israel was the Philistines. The Philistines. Talked about them this morning. I will deliver you from the hand of the Philistines if you do what I preach this morning. Vicious. Steal, kill, destroy. Pulverized. Hated Israel. Wanted to wipe them out. Like many of their surrounding nations today in the Mideast. One scholar said Goliath was 9'7". You see a 7-footer basketball player, you go, my Lord. One of them said, 9'7". The other theologian on television said they were more like 13'4". 9'7" or 13'4". Who gives a rip? I don't care if he's 9'7", 10'7", 11'12", 13'4". It is a, that's a big white boy right there. Amen. Y'all hear me? That's a big boy. 9:7 and 13:4. Let me tell you how big that dude is. He could stand flat-footed in your front yard, shingle the roof on your house without a stepladder. He's a roofer without a ladder. The battles, Hester, are huge. But you've got to learn to press through. You cannot settle for mediocrity. No. You've got to press in to go through the battles, fight them. You're heading north. You're going to the great land that is out there. You still with me?
Yep.
Here we go. What does this have to do with us? What does this have to do with us? Here's what it has to do. When I sense boredom, when I sense blah, is it a word? Blah, blahness, boredom, whatever word you want to use, make up one, it's all the same. When I sense in a people something is blanketing them, watch this. If he can get you where you don't want to do this anymore. Mm-hmm. It ain't about a man or a woman missing. Mm-hmm. It isn't about adultery or being faithful to your spouse all the time. I'm telling you, welcome to the reality of the spirit world. It's not just about the big, black, ugly sins. Mm-hmm. It's not just about the sight of God and the sight of the devil just giving in to temptation. If he can get you circling a mountain where it's just what we do, we just show up and it's just, when's Sunday coming? Oh, dear God. When's Wednesday night going to be over? We're just going to show up and we're just going to do what we do. If he can get us like this from the pulpit to the pew, listen to me, he's got us where he wants us. We do the activities. We still are moving. We call it shaking and baking, but here, we're not getting anywhere. We sense ourselves not progressing. Now watch this. I'm going to give you this. Number one. Here's the gold medal winner. In dealing with people, you have compassed. The message is still for us today. You have circled this same mountain. Moses, tell the people of God, long enough. It is time to get away from our comfort zone. Launch out. It's time to head north. Top, my observation, the top hindering mountain of all times. The top hindering mountain of all times that hinders people from getting where God wants them to get. If you write it down, put it, is the mountain of past failures. The mountain of past failure, whether it was an abortion, ma'am, you had 20 years ago. Whether it was an abortion, sir, you made her get 15 years ago. Some of you have fallen. You keep circling that same mountain. Now listen to me. If God has forgiven you, God has forgotten it. When God forgives, God forgets, but he don't forget until he forgives.
Amen.
Everybody says, well, when he forgives you, he forgets it, but he don't forget until he forgives. There's no statute of limitation with God. He spoke to me years ago. He said, when a man molested a little girl, and it was 70 years ago in the family, and the family was so embarrassed because when it was, they swept it under the rug. You didn't hear about child molestation, incest in families as much years ago as you do today. Family was hushed about it. They swept it under the rug. Everybody got quiet, hoping that she would, the little girl would grow up and be okay and have a normal life. Are you with me? God said to me one time, unless that man repents, that committed it, confesses it to the family, quits blaming her, stops his lying, and confesses it. Amen. He said, when he faces me on that day, it'll be as though, and he's 80 years old, it'll be as though he molested her 5 minutes ago. Amen. Eternal God, time is nothing. Anything that's not repented over, hear me? There's no statute of limitation with God. You'll find out there's not a paper shredder in heaven. You'll find out there's not a broom. You're not going to be able to sweep things under the rug with God. That's when you got to deal with them. There's a mountain of past failures. Even the divorce issue. I hate divorce. God hates divorce. I'll tell you, someone hates divorce more than God. Anybody ever been through one? Mm. Anybody's ever been through one with kids involved? They hate divorce more than God. No doubt in my mind, they hate it more than God. Especially the innocent one that probably was born again. And divorce has been made too easy in America. You got a few $100 starting off, would kick off the ball game with a lawyer. He's licking his lips, drooling over it, because it's easy money for him. But I'm telling you, that doesn't change the way God views it. I love divorced people. God loves divorced people. I don't believe he'll kick you out of his family because you messed up 30 years ago. God wants to help you. God, even the innocent as well as the guilty, when they truly repent, all manner of sins shall be forgiven you. Amen. He didn't say except divorce.
Right.
Baseball players play baseball. That's when you call them baseball players. Okay. Swimmers swim. Runners run and sinners sin. The divorcee that got on a sexual escapade and began to leave his family 32 years ago and go out running women, got burnt out quick, circling the same mountain, listen to me, recognized how wrong he was, but his ex-wife's already remarried. She had to go on with her life. He lost his family. He paid the price. The kids can't stand him. Hear me. I think he's probably reaped enough when he comes crying and asks for the family to forgive him. He can't restore those years that the cankerworm and the caterpillar and the pommel worm and the locust have eaten. What does that man do? I'm going to tell you what he does. We are there to pick him up. We are there. He's circling a mountain of past failures. Amen. We can't even beat down the guilty party. We've got to help him. Let me say this to you. You give many people a chance to lift their head, they'll lift it. I found out during mountain number one, the past failures of individuals. God will not keep a person down if they'll repent of their sin. During the PTL scandal and the Baton Rouge scandal years ago, I never kicked people down. I didn't get up and say, oh, the mercy of the Lord, hallelujah, let's restore, and then kick whoever, named Jim and Tammy, Jimmy's wife, whoever. I didn't sit there and kick them down. I simply told people, you want to know the fact? I'm not condoning anything, but you better hear me. Every human being under my voice tonight, you've done something since you've been born again you don't want nobody to know about.
That's right.
That's right. That's right.
You listen to how I word that, preachers as well.
Yeah.
You've said something, looked at something, laughed at something you shouldn't have. Everybody in here has done something. You've sinned with your eyes, your mouth, your ears,
Amen.
Or your bottle of dough urine.
Yeah.
You've sinned. Dropped it on your wife's floor. It's almost unpardonable. That's almost blasphemy of the Holy Ghost right there. Playing in the kitchen and dropping that on the floor. I just had to throw that in there again tonight. I want to remind the preacher of his sin and needs to repent. Repent, you sinner. Everybody in here has done something since you've been born again.
Yes.
You don't want nobody to know about. And if God could only use people that have never failed, he could have used just one. And his name was Jesus.
Amen.
See, here it is. My failures are multiple. They're in my past. I refuse to circle the merry-go-round with anybody. Mm-hmm. I'm not circling a merry-go-round with a movement. I'm not circling a merry-go-round with family members. I made up my mind years ago, I'm going to remain anointed from my nose to my toes.
Yeah.
I made up my mind, I'm going to a city where the Lamb is light.
Yeah.
I'm going to a city whose builder and maker is God. And I refuse to circle a merry-go-round with anybody. You listen to me.
No.
Mountain number one is the mountain of past failures. Mountain number two is the mountain, and here we go. I felt this strong. It's reading, I'm an evangelist coming through. Church, are you ready?
Ready.
The silver medal winner in the Mountain Olympics. Sinners, excuse me, we're church people here tonight, but mountain number two would have to be the mountain of self-pity. The mountain of hurt, pastors. The mountain of, let me act it out for you. You recognize this?